The Philippine Foreign Affairs Department, meanwhile, reiterates its commitment to the One China policy. In a statement, the DFA cited a joint communique between Beijing and Manila signed in 1975. It states the Philippines recognizes the People's Republic of China as the sole legal government of Beijing. It also respects the position that Taiwan is an integral part of China's territory. China's foreign ministry and its embassies have condemned foreign governments that congratulated Taiwan's Democratic Progressive Party and its president-elect Lai Ching-te. A dire warning from China as Taiwan's ruling Democratic Progressive Party pulls off a historic third straight presidential victory. China's top diplomat says Taiwan's independence will never be possible. Wang Yi adds no election results will change Beijing's stand that Taiwan is part of China. Beijing has never renounced the use of force to bring Taiwan under its control.
Taiwan has never been a country, not in the past, and certainly not in the future. Taiwan independence has never been possible. It has not been possible in the past, and it will never be possible in the future. Anyone on the island of Taiwan who wants to pursue Taiwan independence or split China's territory will be severely punished by history and law.
Taiwan elected Lai Ching-te as its new president, shrugging off warnings by China that his victory would lead to more tensions. The results showed voters backed the party's view that Taiwan is a de facto state and it should boost its defenses against China's threats. China quick to flex its military might following Taiwan's elections. A day after the polls, the People's Liberation Army's Eastern Theater Command published photos on WeChat showing missile boats performing live fire drills. The command is responsible for the area around Taiwan, but it did not specify the location of the drills or directly mention the elections. For one analyst, the result of the elections only points to more instability ahead in the ties between Taiwan and China.
Unfortunately, I think the election results entail that there will likely be a rocky period of cross-strait relations ahead. Now, Beijing will only provide more stabilizing moves towards Taiwan. It will only extend olive branch towards Taiwan if it thinks the next government of Taiwan has staying power. Staying power as in winning the presidency with a convincing margin, as well as hopefully a retaining majority in the parliament. Now, however, Beijing is going to look at DPP that has about 40% or so of the vote only and loses majority in the parliament. And Beijing is going to think maybe if just pressures Taiwan a little bit harder, you'll be enough to make a difference in the next election. And so Beijing has reason to want to push rather than trying to extend the olive branch.
A grueling milestone in the war between Israel and Hamas. Thousands poured in Tel Aviv Sunday to mark 100 days since hostages were taken captive by Hamas militants. A hostage release deal agreed between Israel and Hamas last year ended after 6 days, which saw the release of more than 100 civilians. But over 100 more remain in captivity. The families now pressing the Israeli government to immediately bring the hostages home.
It's unbelievable that 100 days are passed. You know, in our life, we walk, we play with the cellular, we are speaking in the phone, we eat well, we do many, many things, and there are over there 136 people present without food, without light, without water, without any human conditions, and we don't want to think about the things that they make them over there, to the women, to the guys that stays over there.
In other parts of the world, protesters took to the streets of Washington and London to call for an immediate ceasefire in Gaza. The ongoing conflict has killed over 24,000 Palestinians, while millions more have been displaced. Israel's cabinet begins a marathon session to approve the country's amended 2024 budget. The budget will account for a sharp rise in spending to finance the country's war against Hamas, including funds for the military and compensation for reservists and those affected by the fighting. Last year, Israel approved a two-year budget for 2023 and 2024. But the war against Hamas has shaken government finances. The fiscal impact of the war is estimated at 150 billion shekels, assuming the intense fighting ends in the first quarter of this year. Britain's foreign minister defends the airstrikes launched by the UK and the US against Yemen's Houthi rebels. On Friday, US and British warplanes, ships, and submarines launched dozens of airstrikes across Yemen against Houthi forces. The strikes follow months of raids by Houthi fighters who have boarded ships they claimed were Israeli or heading for Israel.
We've given warning after warning. We've taken the case to the United Nations, had a very clear statement there about the importance of freedom of navigation. And yet the attacks continued. We've very much treated military action as a last resort. The strikes themselves were limited, proportionate, targeted, legal, but they were also necessary.
17 Filipino seafarers are among those held hostage by Houthi rebels. Meanwhile, more than 2,000 ships have been forced by the Houthi attacks to divert from the Red Sea since November. Over now to the race for the White House. Republican candidates urging voters in Iowa to brave the extreme cold to get out and vote. The Midwestern state will hold the party's first nominating contest Monday. Former U.S. President Donald Trump's top rivals, Nikki Haley and Florida Governor Ron DeSantis, are banking on good showings in Iowa to derail Trump's bid. But a record cold snap could keep many voters at home.
The big thing, and I say it in every speech, don't sit home. Even if you think we're winning by a lot, it doesn't matter. You have to get out and vote. And we're really setting the table for November by doing that because, you know, we're in very good shape.
I'm asking for your support on Monday night. I'll be a candidate that will help sweep us to victory all across the land. I'll be a leader that you can always be proud of.
It's going to be real cold. But I'll tell you this. You know you set the tone for where the rest of the country needs to go. You know what you need to do, and I know that you'll do it. I trust you. I trust you because I have felt over these last 11 months, Iowans take this process seriously.
Denmark's King Frederik X takes the throne, succeeding his mother, Queen Margrethe II, after more than half a century of monarch. Frederik was proclaimed by Prime Minister Mette Frederiksen on the balcony of Parliament Sunday, joined by his Australian-born wife, Mary, who is now queen, and their children. The abdication is the nation's first in nearly 900 years. Despite freezing temperatures, large crowds filled the streets of Copenhagen to witness the event. Brunei celebrates the wedding of Prince Abdulmateen in a lavish 10-day-long royal ceremony. The wedding celebrations began January 7th and will last through January 16th. The royal wedding guests list includes leaders from neighboring countries, with Philippine President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. joining the ceremony Sunday. Prince Mateen has gained fame in recent years, accompanying his father on diplomatic engagements, and was once dubbed as Asia's most eligible bachelor. Let's find out what stories our North America Bureau is pursuing right now from our Bureau Chief, TJ Manotok.
Good morning to our fans at The Rundown. Here are the top stories in the North American region.
We begin with a new stunning U.S. Congressional Committee report, which alleges that former President Donald Trump violated the U.S. Constitution's Emoluments Clause by getting more than $7.8 million in payments from other countries and their leaders. The report by the Committee on Oversight and Accountability from the Democratic staff identifies the Philippines along with China, Saudi Arabia, Malaysia, and others as countries that spent lavishly on apartments, hotel stays, and events at Trump properties. Page 113 of the report showed that in June 2018, Manila's embassy in Washington, D.C. paid nearly $75,000 for a Philippine Independence Day celebration and reception at the Trump International Hotel in Washington, D.C. This came at a time when the Philippines was seeking a free trade agreement with the U.S., which the Trump administration did not eventually enter into with Manila. The report says then-President Trump showed eagerness to foster close ties with then-President Rodrigo Duterte, even as the latter was criticized for his bloody war on drugs. Philippine Ambassador to the U.S. Jose Manuel Romualdez told ABS-CBN News that he already addressed the issue in 2018 and has no further comment. But in a June 2018 interview, Romualdez said this.
It may sound like a political statement, but maybe it is. It's being held at the Trump Hotel with the President of the United States happens to have the same name as this hotel. So.
In other news, tens of millions of Americans in the Northwest and Midwest are bracing for wicked weather conditions with snowstorms and flooding threatening the East Coast. Airlines canceled or delayed more than 3,600 flights across the U.S. on Friday, including planes grounded at Chicago's O'Hare International Airport due to winds and blinding snow. In the Midwest, people are dealing with blizzard-like conditions, featuring heavy snow and fierce winds of up to 60 miles per hour that were expected to continue into Saturday, the National Weather Service warned. Longtime Filipino residents of Chicago say they're used to the snowy and wet weather, but are taking some steps to stay safe.
I just make sure that I'm wearing layers if I'm going outside. If I'm inside, making sure that my the pipes are running with water so that they don't burst.
Definitely just try to stay inside. Usually a lot of things are canceled. Schools, sometimes, depending on where your job is, of course, sometimes those, you know, people can work from home.
And finally, in sports, a record-setting deal for history-making Filipino-American NBA head coach Eric Spoelstra. The Miami Heat has signed Coach Spoelstra to an 8-year, $120 million extension. The $120 million is the most money ever committed to a North American coach of any pro sport. Since taking over as head coach in 2008, the 53-year-old Spoelstra has led the Heat to 6 NBA Finals, winning 2 championships, and is currently in 19th place when it comes to all-time coaching wins. Spoelstra addressed the contract extension shortly before Wednesday night's home game against the Oklahoma City Thunder, showing appreciation for the franchise's owners and leaders who have stuck with him for nearly 30 years.
It's very humbling, you know, to be able to have that kind of continued stability, you know, and then, you know, basically, if, you know, for the staff as well, you know, that we can wrap our minds around, you know, the foreseeable future.
And those are the top stories making the headlines amongst the Filipino community in North America. You can catch more of our TFC News on our website, news.abs-cbn.com/TFCnews, on the ABS-CBN News YouTube channel, and on the ABS-CBN News app for your smartphones and tablets. Back to our friends at The Rundown.